Welcome to Cognitive Rampage Podcast. Hope you're taking care of you. Hope you're living your cognitive rampage. We are finally live. A lot of technical difficulties, but the way MMA and UFC has been going, it seems like those technical difficulties keep popping up all the time. So we got through the technical stuff. We are about to go, but you know, I got to tell you just a few things. The second edition of the Cognitive Rampage, a scientific approach to self-discovery, change, and life optimization will be coming out on 4/20. It is coming out. I did not plan that date, actually. That's just when the publisher got it ready. So I figured, hey, why not? I'll take the date. So check out that new book. Like I tell everybody, if you bought the first edition, you can no longer buy the first edition, by the way. So you are holding a limited edition. And I can't believe it. They were actually selling one of the limited editions for like $1,200. Don't pay that. All right. If you want a first edition, I got like three of them laying around. Hit me up. I'll send it to you for like $500. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. But the second edition, if you did buy the first, send us or email me a picture proof at cognitiverampagepodcast@gmail.com. And I will more than happily send you your free edition, free electronic copy of the second edition of the Cognitive Rampage. You can also mental train with myself now. Just go to cognitiverampage.com/mental training or just click on mental training when you get there. That's my style of training. I'm an ex and an emphasis on the ex of mental health counselor. Didn't like a lot of the ways that they prolong it when I think we can get a lot done. I call it kicking your front door psychology. That's the way I like to practice. Trust me, it's not for the faint of heart. So if you want to call about your feelings, you probably don't want to call at all. It's about changing the paradigm of the way you think, getting deep into your beliefs. That's how we work when you work with mental training with me one-on-one. Also, last but not least, we have been running this podcast now for about 2 years, all on my dime, all of everything we could pay and afford to upgrade everything, buying new equipment, paying guests to come on sometimes, etc. But it's getting there. It's getting about that time. So I don't want to bring sponsors on because every podcast I listen to that has like 6 minutes of sponsorship, you just click, click, click forward through that anyway. So the way we're doing it is simply through PayPal. You can just go again to cognitiverampage.com, find the donate button, click on that. You can make a one-time donation or you can set up for a monthly donation. It's up to you. I think the lowest they let us do is like $3. But any bit that you send is helpful. I appreciate it so much. That's why I try to give away everything I do. I do live Facebook videos where people can ask me what they're going through, etc. I try to give away as much as I can because the real basis of foundation is trying to help people. I think I have some sort of talent for it. So if I can give it away and help people and somehow manage to eat along the way, then I'm happy and I'm good. Now, it's time. I wish I could do it like that. They pay me enough money to do it like that. I've been trying to get somebody on this man's level of training on to the show for a long time now. Patricia Ba was kind enough to reach out, make that connection, and the man is here himself. Frankie Sanchez is coming on the podcast. I'm trying to read this long bio, but it's so long about his sports background and history. I mean, my gosh, man, the resume is ridiculous. 5-year NCAA Division II wrestler at Adams State College. Hey, preface, I don't own that college. I have nothing to do with it. But you got a Golden Glove, 6-time Colorado Golden Gloves boxing champion. In 2000, he was the USA National Pankration champion for Grapplers Edge Academy. Retired with a record of 34-0 in tough man and MMA fighting. A professional boxing record of 16 wins, 15 L's, 1 decision, 8 KOs. The man's got a must have a heavy hand there. Professional boxer. Fought 32 pro fights. It goes on. We could keep going. During his professional career, chief sparring partner to world champion and legend Roberto Hands of Stone Duran. Come on, Roberto Duran. My gosh. 4-time world champion Juan Baby Bull Diaz. It goes on and on and on. And we'll probably talk about how he's also in Conor McGregor's camp, but I don't want to get to that just yet. The man has so much to offer. He's been so humble on the phone, going through the technical issues we have. He volunteered his time now. He does so much. He's a family man, a very proud family man, one heck of a chef, I hear, too. Just so much to get to on this one. Frankie, welcome to the podcast, brother.
Man, I appreciate you having me.
Oh, I'm glad you could come on, man. You know, I do a little mental training with athletes on the side, but nothing with a resume like yourself, man. But before we roll into that, man, where do you come from? What was childhood like? What shaped you in this direction? Obviously, you're a wrestler in high school, but walk me through what it was like, man.
Sure, man. You know, I was born and raised here in Aurora, Colorado. My family has roots to southern Colorado. It's the smallest town in Colorado. It's the San Luis Valley. And if people know boxing, they know that the great Manasseh Mahler, Jack Dempsey, was from there. Just a very small town, very poor, one of the poorest in the nation, I mean. But my family was raised there. They were fortunate enough to bring me up to Aurora for hopefully a better life, myself and my brother. I have an older brother. But yeah, born and raised here as from elementary to junior high, then high school in Aurora. But my grandfather, actually, he was the Southern Pacific boxing champion of the world in 1945 for the Army team. And kind of just, you know, got fed that when I was little. You know, he always wanted me to, you know, try out his hands in boxing and my hands and teach me things. So that kind of worked. I started, you know, a little later than most kids did. I started about 7 years old in boxing. I did the Junior Olympics.
Did you say a little later than most kids at 7 years old?
I mean, nowadays you get kids that are coming in. I mean, when they can, they're in the gym since they can, you know, baby crawl. So I think that for boxing, yeah, I mean, the kids that I was fighting at that time already had somewhere between 60 and 100 fights in boxing. I was 0-0 in boxing. So yeah, by the time of my first Golden Gloves fight, I fought a kid who was 96 amateur fights by the name of Frank Trevino. So, I mean, it just shows you the level that these guys are at, like the Oscar De La Hoyas. Those guys trained since they were small. And that's how it is now with wrestling and MMA. If you look at some of the videos, you see some of these kids that are unbelievable. But back to my story, you know, God had a good family. My mom and dad were hard workers. You know, they worked hard to get us a better life and try to get us out of Denver, move us into Aurora, which at the time was very, very good area. Aurora, it's getting a little rougher now, but, yeah, I mean, my goal was always just to box, and I like your podcast because you talk about a lot of the mental part of it, and that's really what it is. It's a big mental part, and that's what I had as a child. I'd always try to, research things, training, look at old videos of, you know, what other athletes did, you know, not just boxers, not just taekwondo, but, you know, runners, things like that. So, you know, I won a lot of amateur titles in boxing, and I wrestled in high school, did very well. I took second my senior year. So it was more of, I trained very hard. I wasn't the best athlete. I didn't have all the skills, but I really worked. I think I worked mentally and physically, outworked my opponents all the time, you know? So, I did a lot of research on opponents as much as I could back then without the internet. But, yeah, I mean, just, had a very successful career in amateur. In 1992, I tried out for the Olympic team. I won the state United States boxing championships here in the state. But unfortunately, Oscar De La Hoya was in my weight in 1992. And of course, no one beat him that year. The kid was unstoppable. But, you know, Oscar and I were friends. Every tournament that I was at as a child, he was at the same weight. If it was a national tournament, he was from East Los Angeles. I was from Colorado. You know, we never fought in any of those tournaments. We sparred together in some training camps, but never fought at that level for that gold medal. I was in the U.S. Nationals, but he won it that year, and I didn't. So I went on to college, got a degree in history government, and I wrestled for 5 years on the Adams State Division II wrestling team, which was pretty top ranked school still. So that after that, you know, I did some tough man contests and stuck with it. And but that's kind of how it went. Turned pro in boxing, did all this before the UFC got really big. They had tournaments called Vale Tudo or NHB, No Holds Barred. So I fought in 32 fights. You're talking, they'll put us in like an arena on wrestling mats, and they make us fight sometimes 6-7 times a day. I'm kind of like the old UFC before it got sanctioned. So I had a lot of wars. Fortunately, I never lost. I got 3 belts in mixed martial arts, and I got a national title in Pankration is the name of the sport, and it's one of the oldest sports in the world, and it's basically anything goes, just no strikes to the head. So takedowns, kicks, body punches, locks, leg locks, and I won that for world-class coach Sheldon Marr at Grapplers Ed. So been around, and now I'm just training fighters, and I got a food truck company, so I'm really, really a jack of all trades, master of none, but I have done a lot. I mean, I've been very fortunate. So my food company has taken off really well here in Colorado, and yeah, it's been going good. So that's kind of a little bit about my life.
A little bit that most people don't achieve a fourth of that resume in their sports, their entire career, Frankie. I mean, you're underplaying what you're doing. I mean, what a cool opportunity to be coming up in the same fighting rings with the Golden Boy himself. I mean, you were trying everything from the pain craze that you were talking about. I mean, wrestling, fighting MMA. How long was it when UFC actually started hitting where you were out, when you kind of left doing that and start and focused on training?
You know, probably around 2002, because, but even then they still didn't have the there was just three weight classes, and that was like the 165, and I was still a small fighter. So when I was fighting in these tournaments, I mean, you're talking, it was anywhere from 140 to 190, and then they'd go to 190 to whatever it was, and then super heavy. So I'd be fighting guys. I got stuff on YouTube where I'm fighting guys that are like 250 pounds, and I'm knocking them out, you know? So,
but hey, you're like a true gladiator, man. They really just pulled some gladiator movie shit on you, put you in the pit, and I'm surprised you weren't fighting lions and shit.
Yeah, you know, it could have been. If they were paying me, I probably would do it.
It seems like it, man. Man, all right, remind me never to piss off Frankie ever. Oh, man, I'm glad the technology kept you on the low, man. You didn't start choking the damn computer out, man.
Right, right.
So when obviously what I had Kyle Dake on, who's an all-around wrestler on the Olympic team. Now, we talked a lot about his mental training and mental health, and he came from a similar background to yours, meaning he had lineage in fighters and wrestlers, etc. And how much of the influence do you think in the mental game of yours was passed down from the lineage?
I mean, that was a big part of it. You know, I've always had top-notch coaches. Now, at the time, I may have not realized they were top-notch, but, I mean, you're talking about my former amateur trainer, who's unfortunately passed away a few years ago, Ralph Luna. This guy had knowledge that he passed down not only in the ring but in life, you know, telling you how to succeed in life, how to, you know, get up in the morning, make your bed, you know, be here on time, don't be late, eat good food, don't eat bad food. So that kind of stuff, as a child growing up, you need to have that, because if it was me, I'd be drinking soda and eating candy bars every day. But, you know, you get good people like him. I mean, I've had Sheldon Marr, who is a world famous UFC coach, and he's really well known. He was one of my coaches, and my coach Roger Jalucka in college. I mean, these guys are coming from years and years of experience with some of the best athletes in the world that they trained under. So myself as an athlete, I wasn't just there to learn the wrestling or the boxing or the MMA. I always pick their brain about stuff, you know, like, you know, what, how can I be better than this? How can I be better than that? You know, what can I do to mentally be better? And that's why I say I really like your what you're doing, because people don't realize how strong the mind is. And like I told you, I was never, a physically fit athlete. I mean, in most of my pro fights, I always looked like I was chunky, but that's because some bodies are different than others. I didn't have the right nutritionist. I basically trained myself for some of these pro fights. So, but knowing now and the technology that these athletes have now with internet, it's amazing. And that's why these athletes are just getting better, better and better. And from when the UFC first started till now, oh my God, the level has changed. And I've been very fortunate enough. A friend of mine who I met in 2008 is the Olympic gold medalist, Henry Cejudo, currently ranked number 2 in the world in the flyweight division. Him and I have been picking each other's brains since 2008 about how to better these athletes, how to mentally prepare them, how to physically prepare them, how to weight cut. So having a gold medalist on your team right now is probably one of the biggest accomplishments I've had in a long time.
Yeah, I think a lot of people sometimes have a misconception of pro fighters, be that boxers or MMA fighters, that they come across as these arrogant type people. And I can say just about every one of them that I met come across so humble, and they're almost very inquisitive. It's always asking the next person, how's this get better? How does this get better? You rarely see that arrogant solid wall of, I got this figured out.
You're right. And when they do that, that's unfortunate, because there's always room to learn. You can never not learn enough, especially from someone. And that's why I always encourage fighters that I'm training now to, hey, if you need to go to a different gym and try to get a, you know, different look, go ahead, you know. But if you're going to commit to me for the fight. But I encourage you to go do taekwondo, go do karate, go do wrestling, judo, whatever you can, because all this is going to help you. You know, it's such a well-rounded sport now that you have to be top-notch in everything you do. So I do encourage that. And, you know, like I said, dealing with these Olympic wrestlers, Olympic level wrestlers like Kyle and Henry, you learn a lot just by being in the room, watching them, you know, and they're learning from you too, believe it or not. They ask a lot of questions, and, you know, cause they know we've been there. We're pro athletes, former pro athletes, and we've been there. So they do ask that. And like I said, I've had so many great opportunities. Like you mentioned, I was one of the last mans in history to spar with the legendary Roberto Duran, who, this guy, I mean, this is a guy who I grew up watching, and, you know, I was humbled to be in there. And when he fought Camacho here in Denver, it was called Battle of the Ages. I believe they were about 50-51. I tell you what, I sparred this guy for about 40-some rounds, and he hit me harder than any of the world champions that I fought, you know, did. And this guy, I could only imagine him during his amateur career. The guy was a beast. And it was just great to spar with him and learn, talk to him about, you know, his career.
Yeah, I probably would probably sit with you for an hour and just say, okay, what did this person tell you? What was their angle? Is there somebody that when you were younger that mentioned something to you? Because I know I got a lot of things in my head sometimes to where I'm older and I look back and I go, man, I remember what that old dude told me, you know, sitting there that one. Is there something that you've taken that you learned when you were younger that maybe you instill in your fighters that come under you?
Yeah, you know, there was. And my grandfather, you know, his name was Phil Filomeno Sanchez. And he told me as an amateur, you know, I was asking about tricks or whatever. He told me, you know, son, there is everybody has a breaking point in them. Once you know where that breaking point is, you got it controlled. Whether the breaking point be at weigh-ins, whether it be when you're in an interview with somebody or when that first bell rings or first punch hits, you know. And as a wrestler, I learned that more as I got older. But yeah, I mean, if you know, see in some of these boxing matches or MMA fights or whatever, a race, you can always see a breaking point in someone. If there's two people competing for that last or the first finish, you'll see a breaking point. And when you realize that, then I think you can handle it. And a big part of my pro career, just I fought some of the best in the world, sometimes on a 2-week notice. It was that I always knew in my mind that if this thing got to a real fight, I would beat them, because at the time they didn't really know much about UFC fighting or MMA fighting. So I'd say that always got me there. And I mean, they put me in against guys like a young champion named Kermit Cintron, who was 29-0 out of Puerto Rico, trained in Reading, Pennsylvania. He was knocking out everybody. And I'm like, you know what? This guy's a beast. He's an animal, but I'm not afraid of him. If we need to go heads up, we'll go heads up outside and I'll beat him. So that got me, last me. I didn't get knocked out. He stopped me. The referee stopped it. But you're talking about me standing in the ring with Olympians who they thought were going to punish me in the first round. And I, you know, last more of it was mental, because I knew they're not going to break me. You know, I'm a man just like them. I put on my pants just like them. I'm going to sit in there, you know, and that's what I did. So I think that helped me a lot through my career. My grandfather, like I said, everybody has a breaking point. And even when you lose, though, you know when you break. And that's the thing. Once you know that, when you're losing and winning, it'll help you through your career.
Yeah, I would. What's one of the maybe a loss that you experienced along the way? It doesn't matter where or what age, that maybe taught you the most or taught you the most about yourself even. And what lesson did you take away from?
There was a couple of them, but I can remember one to where I guess I didn't give up on fighting, but I was a pro and I was either going to make the cut to keep going on and making bigger money or just stay mediocre and maybe make $10,000 a fight or whatever it was. So it was a kid by the name of Dimitri Salita. He's a Jewish kid out of New York. He was a 2-time national Golden Glove champion, very elite athlete, signed by Bob Arum. And he had a big following with the Jewish community. And I fought him on the undercard of HBO card in Phoenix, Arizona, under Margarito and Katskiz, I believe his name was. But anyway, we had a standing ovation at our fight, but that is a true fight that I gave everything I had, and I really believed in my heart I won. But with the politics in boxing is so corrupt that they gave it to him. I mean, the crowd was even booing it. We got we were published in Ringside Magazine as, you know, one of the fights of the night, standing ovation. But I think that after that fight, my heart just dropped. I said, you know what? I trained hard for this fight. I know I beat this kid. The judges saw something different, but in my heart, I won. The crowd thought I won. And that right there kind of broke me from just training. So the rest of the time was just like, you know, take fights for money. Go in there, give it your best. If you lose, you lose. So I didn't have a heart after that. But that kind of put me out, because I was at the point in my time where the money really helped. You know, I was trying to pay for school, trying to, you know, get stuff ready for my child and my wife. But yeah, when you get a situation like that, when you train so hard and you give everything you got and you know you won and you lose, that happens. And you still see that happen a lot today in some of these fighters.
Yeah, it's something you can't control, right? As the fighter, we want to be in control of ourselves, the ring. And then all of a sudden, when these judges take something from you like that, I can see that why that would be so detrimental, because you start to say, fuck, there's nothing else I can do here. And what did you do? Did you pull yourself back out of that? What did you do over the time to get yourself out of that mind frame to get back in it?
You know what? Just knew that anytime you're a fighter, that you can get hurt in that ring. You know, you could die. You could die from one hit. There could be, you know, blood clot to your brain or whatever. So just prepared myself. I didn't prepare at 100%, maybe 80%. But, you know, I kind of went on because I knew it was towards the end of my career. And I said, well, you know, use it, experience it. You know, do what you got to do to take advantage of it. And that's what I actually did in my last pro fight. My father never really got to travel the world. I got offered a fight against the Canadian national champion, Adam Green. So I said, hey, you know what? I'm about 15, 16 pounds over 2 days before. I said, I'm just going to go and not make weight. And I'm just going to want to get my father to go to Canada with me. So we got a free trip to Canada. I think I got paid $14,000 for the fight, lost in the fifth round. I was so tired. I hadn't been training, but I used it, took advantage of it. I said, you know what? I'll go out there and give it my best, but I know no matter what I do, unless I knock him out, I'm not going to win the fight there in Canada as their hometown hero. So, but you took advantage of it, got to see Montreal. It was a great city. And, you know, that's what I did with it. So I got to meet some very great people. I did a motivational speech in San Bernardino. And then on my way back, I was stopped at LA airport, and in comes Muhammad Ali in a wheelchair. And I walked up to his nurse, which is a male nurse. And I said, hey, I just fought on the Layla Ali. I was a co-main event for Layla Ali, Christy Martin, back in Mississippi and Biloxi. You were in the front row. I know that you don't want everyone to know that you're here, but can I grab a picture? His nurse said, no, you can't. I don't want everyone knowing where he's at. Well, about 10 minutes later, the nurse runs down the airport to grab me and says, hey, Muhammad Ali's taking pictures now. He said, you can grab a picture. So if you've seen that picture, that's one of the most incredible photos I've ever got. And, you know, he's really bad with Parkinson's, but his nurse told him, put up your hand. And he was shaking, and they got a couple pictures of that. And that's one of my prized possessions, because everybody knows Muhammad Ali. He was a humanitarian for the sport. He just, you know, was good for it. And that was a pretty good honor, and one of the best pictures that I keep up of him.
Man, you seem to be the master of the silver lining, that I like to call it, and trying to find the silver lining in anything that you do and to push forward. Where do you find, where most fighters find it, difficult to find the silver lining, in the two-part to it being, where do you see most early fighters or young fighters in the game fail mentally?
Mentally, they're always out for the money, you know, which is, it's good or bad, I don't know, but they're more about for the money. So you still gotta have a love for the sport. You gotta love what you do. It's like work. If you don't like what you do, then don't do it. Try something else. And I try to encourage my fighters, and I think that I try to be very positive. You know, even though it's a tough life and you have your ups and downs, you always got to stay focused. And I've learned that from a lot of my friends, a lot of people I meet. They're like, you're always positive. I'm like, well, if you hang around negative people, you're going to have a negative point of view. You're going to get in that, you know, kind of spiral. So even if my father or something says, oh, I had a bad day, I'll say, well, think about it this way. You're still walking. There's guys that are your age that are in wheelchairs or, you know, can't even move. So, you know, try to find the positives in life. And that's how I go with the mental part of the training. I try to tell these guys, you know, look at something good. So you're 21. Yeah, you got beaten sparring today, but guess what? There's a lot of guys who can't spar anymore, or, you know, and you still have a possibility of making money. I guess I just try to, like I said, stay positive with them and make them think that, if you think positive, you're going to live a positive life. If you hang around negative people, you're going to live a negative life. So, you know, I get encouragement from, anywhere from billionaires to, you know, I do a food truck feeding the homeless every holiday that I can. And I talk to these homeless, and I want to know their story. I'm not just trying to gain attention from media. I really want to focus on how I can help these people. And if I was a billionaire, I'd be out giving money out every day, believe it or not. But unfortunately, I'm not. So I'm only me. And, but we, you know, we feed like a 1,500, 1,600 homeless people on Thanksgiving. To me, that's something that that I'm supposed to. That's something that you should do as a human being. You got to help your other human beings out. And like I said, it's not just about me training these guys for fighting. I want to train them for life. And that's kind of why I've connected with my good friend Henry Cejudo, the Olympic champion, because he says, hey, come and talk to these fighters from Brazil that you're training. They're living in a one-bedroom house that's concrete with no heating, air conditioning, no running water. Give them a little feedback and tell them how blessed they are. So that's kind of why y'all also brings me into these camps as a mental coach, and let them know that, you know, life is short. You got to enjoy it, and you got to make the best of it, and be very happy if you get these opportunities, and make it worth your while. So that's kind of how I live.
Yeah, it's shining through, man. I know it's just on a screen, but I can feel that positive energy. I, you know, some of the fighters that I do work with, I like to talk about that a happy fighter is a focused fighter. And I'm not a mental coach for in the ring, right? I'm not Mr. Miyagi. I like to say, you guys are that. You guys are the pro fighters from the ring. I tend to focus on people's outside, their family, their structure, being the ex-mental health counselor, being a mental trainer, about balancing the life, because the life of a high-performance athlete is pretty crazy. And I've seen many different mental preparations for fights. You got some that get angry, some that just try to stay happy and loose. Do you believe that there's kind of a way that you approach a fight that should kind of be everybody? Are you a fan of the get angry, get pumped and run out? Or are you a fan more of the happy fighter, focused fighter?
You know, and I'm so glad you brought that up because I wanted to talk to you about that. Yeah, and let me just give you the best, truest story that I can tell you. I just recently, after all my years of training, was a coach in the UFC. They just had a show here in Denver, and it was for a gentleman by the name of Alejandro Pantoja, who is from Brazil. And I was asked to be a coach on The Ultimate Fighter Season 24, which I went and did, which was amazing. I couldn't do the whole, because of my food truck company, I couldn't do the whole 6 weeks, but Henry brought me out on the last 2 weeks, and it was one of the most amazing experiences of my life. I got to actually go into the fighter house. I don't know if you've ever seen the show. To the gym, train these guys. I mean, it was amazing. You're talking swimming pools. You're talking the best fighters in the world. Anything they want to eat, Dana would bring into them. But long story short, on the show, he was just injured and lost in the semifinals, but he got called up to fight one of the top fighters that I think in the world, Eric Shelton. And fortunately, we beat him, and Eric Shelton brought on one of the best coaches, who's a friend of mine, Dwayne Lugwood, in the world. So they're like, okay, so Frankie Sanchez is going to be working the stand-up. He's not known for a coach right now, but this Dwayne Ludwig has millions of fighters under him that follow him. You know, you're talking Uriah Fabers, you're talking, Joe Benavidez, guys like that are elite fighters, and I'm going against him. So a big part of our camp was the mental aspect. I mean, I actually went down there and stayed with them in a bed R&B. We were training at the Olympic Training Center. We ate together. We goofed off together. We sang karaoke together. We talked together. And although we had a little problems, I don't speak much Portuguese, but he understands. But that mental part, I think, won the fight for us. We weren't a better fighter than him. You know, it could have been a coin toss, but I think we took him down and controlled him more, and we're better on our feet. But the mental aspect of it, we had barbecues together. I talked to him about his kids. I talked to him about what he's going to do when he makes this money, what he should pay off, what he should save for taxes. So this is stuff that he'd never been talked about before in Brazil. So I think in his mind, mentally, he was tougher than Eric Shelton, not physically, but we won that fight. And now he's got a 4-fight contract with the UFC, and he's gonna make some big waves in this division. So it's things like that, which you brought up with the mental part of it. Just like I said, letting him know what he sacrificed, and letting him know what the rewards are gonna be if he keeps sacrificing and stays out of the bar or stays out of the trouble that some of these MMA fighters do. You gotta have a sacrifice if you're going to want to be a world champion, and you got to give up a lot, but is it worth it to you? If not, let us know now, because we have other fighters who want to train, but to him it is. And like I said, we're waiting for his next fight to come up. But mentally, I think he was prepared, and just being part of a family, that kind of helped it, I think.
Yeah. What I like to say is, let's say you're in the ring with one of those elite killers, and for a second it crosses your mind, is my wife mad at me? Or, did my girlfriend cheat on me? Are they coming for me for taxes? Do I got to pay that? Let that go for a half a second. And that's all this super champion athlete gladiator needs, is that half a second when your mind's out the ring. And it sounds like that's what you did. You were able to answer some probably inner questions for him that he wasn't sure about. And when that's calm, you gave him the connectedness. And I can tell you, any coach I've ever bonded with like that, I don't just feel like I'm letting myself down if I lose. I feel like I'm fighting for my family almost at that point.
Yeah, and that's a good point. And like I said, and I told him we like to have fighters. I mean, back in the old school, you would have to go get away from your wife. They'd say don't have sex before 3 weeks or even 3 months before the fights. And I kind of followed that. I really did. Whether it worked or not, I don't know. I mean, so we brought him up here, and he left his whole family from over there in Brazil. So, having to suffer like that, he has kids, you're not able to see him, and it is tough. But yeah, we try to focus on that, saying, look, man, whatever problems you have, let it go now. It's fight night, it's fight week, whatever it is. Don't do the trash talking. I've really never been a trash talker. I know they do it with the Conors, with the Mayweathers, with some of these fighters. They're trying to sell tickets now, and that's kind of understandable. But I've always told my fighters to be humble. I mean, it's a sport, it's mixed martial arts or it's boxing. It's never been known as a WWE talk crap kind of thing. I mean, but some of these fighters are doing it right. They want to build it up, and it does sell tickets. But in the end, I'm still more of an old school guy. The Muhammad Ali, he did a lot of trash talking, but he backed it up. But that built on, and a lot of people still go off of how he built up fights. But I was more of be the humble person, be the better person. If this guy says, your wife's a whatever, and trying to get you riled up, just tell him, okay, well, let my fist talk or let my feet talk in the ring. So I encourage that. I'm now, like I said, always been be a better person, and it'll reward you in the long run, is how I've always thought about that.
Yeah, I think the humble fighter, I reference football a lot. That's what I played for a long time even. But that humbleness that you have allows you, I think, to grow faster than the, say, concrete fighter who has this probably false arrogance, that buildup of it. I always like to say if there were two men equal in stature and fear, looking scary, sitting there, and one of them is running their mouth talking shit and the other one's sitting there quiet, which one don't you want to fight? And yeah. I'm not fighting the quiet guy sitting there. I'm gonna fight that barking pit bull who's telling me he's terrified.
Yep. Yeah, you're absolutely right. And that's I like watching these videos on YouTube of the smart ass fighter who's talking this smack and then gets knocked out, because it's true. Karma will get you eventually. Might not be that day, but it'll get you. And like I said, just again, I encourage you. Your fighter, your whatever athlete, try to be the best person you can. Give back to the community. And I've always promised my grandfather and my parents that I would always. Give back, go teach a boxing class if you can. And even though I'm so busy, I'll always find time for that. And I was very humbled too. A few weeks back, one of the Reebok/UFC equipment people that deal with that sent me a box of about 300 t-shirts and said, "Hey, we know you're doing good things. Do what you got to do with them." Didn't ask me about it. I went to a boxing club, a very poor boxing club here in my neighborhood. Gave it to like 60 of the students. They loved it. Went to a wrestling team yesterday. Gave them shirts. A friend of mine, her daughter or her son is, been handicapped for since a child. I gave him t-shirts. He wore it to school. There's stuff like that that we need to do. I mean, it's a $40 shirt, but it means a lot to these kids. Some of these kids, you tell them, "Hey, I'm a UFC coach," or, "this and that. I work with Henry Cejudo, an Olympic champion," and you give them something, it means a lot to them. Maybe that day it puts them on the right path to go and accomplish their goal. So I love doing that. I really do. If I had Reebok and a USC sponsor me every day, I'd be out every day giving out equipment, even to homeless, even to, I was at a buddy of mine's, an Aurora cop. He does a lot for keeping our streets safe. Graham Dunn, I went down to his Fit Republic store and gave him some shirts. I said, "Hey, all the coaching that you helped me with volunteering, this is for you. It may not mean a lot, but take it." And he was really humbled by it. So yeah, I mean, I don't know. I just keep encouraging these guys, do good. And karma will help you.
Well, I'm waiting. We'll interview one of those boxing kids from Aurora you gave a shirt to, who will hold on to that for the next 10 or so years. And once they take some championship, we'll have him on the podcast. He'll probably hold that shirt up and go, "Thank you, Frankie," at the time. And yeah, it'll hit you randomly, man. I wanted to kind of go back a little bit. It'll lead into another question, but do you see a difference in the outcome of a fighter when they do approach the fight with this very hyped up, angry focus? And I'm talking when they're coming out of the tunnel, this, getting mad at something or hyping themselves up. Do you see a difference in the outcome when the fighter seems to be more relaxed, when they're walking into it with a smile, or seem to be happier, if you will?
And if you watch, it's a good question. If you watch these YouTube videos, there's a fighter by the name of Fedor Emelianenko. Just a tough Russian. He was always like his brother. It served the best. You get his brother fought this big guy. He looked like a 300-pound stud, just ripped up. Guys laughing at him. He's just up there shaking his head. He's chunky. Don't even care. And the fight went like 25 seconds, and Emelianenko knocked him out. So, yes, I mean, everyone does something different. You get these college wrestlers who some like to be, extra pumped up, and then you get some mellow guys. I don't know if either works. I always saw myself, it always worked if you're mellow, because when you're doing that, you're exerting a lot of energy. When you're running around, when you're getting wild, I'm thinking, do you save your energy for the fight, especially if it's going to be a 5-round championship fight? So, I don't know any statistics to say, well, this fighter, because he was calm, he won. But my own philosophy would be save your energy for the ring. You're going to need it. Or save your energy for the cage. Don't get all wild in the back screaming and, doing a million push-ups. Save everything for the cage. And that's how I look at it. But I see some of these fighters, they just sometimes make themselves look stupid, and they think that they're going to, they're going to get more fans or something. But, it's kind of funny. And I tell all the fighters, after you win, be humble about it. Don't start jumping on that cage because you'll get fined. And sure enough, the last fight, I think it was in New York, one of the fighters jumped on the cage. I think he got fined $10,000 by the commission. So, yeah, you're talking about a fighter. I'm like, they specifically tell you, don't jump on the cage. You might even get suspended, because what they're afraid of is that he'll get hurt or he can fall on somebody, which is understandable. And he did. And I just read it that I think it was $10,000 fine that he's going to have to pay before he fights again. So, was it do any good to act crazy? Probably not.
Yeah, I'm with you. I'm going to walk into a subject that many fighters and even just people in life that aren't necessarily fighters, people trying to start businesses or having kids, etc. The big four-letter word, fear. I get approached a lot talking about fear. I've talked to a few fighters that tell me, "Hey, I want to get rid of my fear. I don't want to have my fear at all." Where does fear come into play? How do you coach your fighters through the fear? Is it possible to eliminate all the fear? Do you use the fear? What's your approach when you do have that big four-letter word pop up?
Both. I mean, no matter how hard I trained, you know, when I first started the MMA stuff, it was basically, I remember not being able to sleep or eat for 3 days because they're like, hey, you're getting in this tournament. It's called Warrior Challenge. You need to, you're going to be fighting. It's called Valley Stow. You can kick, knee to the face, knee to the head, choke out. So, I mean, there were days I couldn't eat. I was so nervous, but I kind of overcame that after the first tournament that I won, you know, just knowing that, hey, these guys are just like you. I mean, no matter what, they may be able to jump higher, hit you harder, but they're human just like you. In the end, they wipe their ass just like you. They put their shoes on and their pants on just like you, one leg at a time. So I tell these fighters, fear is good, but you know, if you don't have fear, then something might be wrong. Everyone's gonna have a little fear no matter what they tell you. But like I just try to tell them, try to relax. You train hard for this fight. I try to encourage them, you know, you're doing this for your family. It's a great career if you make it that way. But yeah, I mean, it's tough because you're talking about some of these fighters fighting in arenas with 15, 20,000 people. They're on pay-per-view. They're towns in Brazil that are hosting the fight at a, you know, for their whole town and little bars. So, I mean, yeah, you just got to get over that. If you know, you're going to have a problem with that it's going to cost you. You start thinking too much, you know, just go out there. I tell them, do how you trained. And that's what we try to do. Train like you're going to fight. So, you know, we put them in situations to where, you know, if you get hurt, if you get hit like this, you know, back up, whatever, cover up, protect yourself. So, you know, you just try to give them all the different scenes they could face in a fight. And the big thing in MMA or in boxing, anything, is everybody has a plan until they get punched in the face. So that's a big part too. You know, you try to make sure they're sparring. If they're sparring and they're getting hit hard and they're not knowing how to control it, maybe they're not ready. So maybe they need a few more months of training or whatever. But yeah, I mean, everybody has a plan until you get punched in the face. So that's something you can't teach, is how to take a punch. That's what I've learned. And I was fortunate that for some reason I knew how to take a punch. And that's kind of what guided me through my career. But yeah, there's some fighters that can't. Once they get hit, career's over.
Mm. Do you shift your mental training approach? Say someone has a fight lined up and it's whether 3 months, whatever, how far. When you begin camp, is the mental training change from, say, fight week, fight night from the beginning of camp?
Yeah, and you know, usually these fighters will have at least a couple months to train, and so and that's a good thing about being a great coach, and that's the good thing about having our team Cejudo, is that we know how a fighter can peak and how they can go down, because you can actually train so much that you peak too soon, and during that fight it seems like you've never trained. So yeah, you got to know that part of it, and I've learned that from, you know, all the years of fighting and coaching, you know, where to peak a fighter out, so they usually stay in shape. Out of season. But once they get that fight, yeah, mentally you start getting ready. You start focusing. As you get closer to the fight, you start telling them, okay, you're not going to call your wife 5 times a day. Now you're going to start focusing on this fight. We're going to start watching videos. We're going to start, you know, getting down to the nitty gritty. But yeah, you really can win or lose a fight. And like I said about the last fight we just fought in the UFC, I really believe that was because of the coaching. We had Eric Albatacin, who was one of the best wrestling coaches in the world, Henry Cejudo, and myself. And, We call ourselves what was it? Guys like gold medal chant. I forgot the name of it, but we called a dream team is what we called ourselves, because hey, you put us three together and we obviously won. So, you know, we got the dream team name, and it worked for us. So if you can get the best coaches, not just trainers, but mental coaches too. So, but I know Henry, and I was going to tell you about this during the Olympics. I forgot what the name of it was, but it's kind of similar to what you do. They made him a recording when he went to sleep about mental toughness, you know, where he came from, repeated things. You will be the Olympic champion. You will be a gold medalist. You will do this. You will make weight. And he tells me that helped him a lot. And that's why I like this mental part of it, because it's all mental. I mean, yeah, you'll get some freaks of nature that like a Mike Tyson that, you know, he's just going to be a beast anyway. But you know, most of the time you're not, and you got to be mentally tough, mentally coached, and physically coached. So, you know, there's the mental part of it's amazing, and we're trying to feed onto them. That's why I'm so happy to be on your show, because I want my fighters to watch this. I want my kids to watch it and say, hey, it's not just about being a good athlete. You know, you get some of these kids that are born with six packs. You know what I mean? Other guys like us, we have to maybe do millions and millions of sit-ups a night and still don't have six packs. So yeah, physically and mentally, is a big part of the game. And it doesn't matter about just fighting. It's football, basketball, hockey. And I've trained NHL hockey players. I trained NFL football players. I talked to a friend of mine who's a real good friend. He's the owner of Remax, Dave Liniger. He tells me mental stuff about, you know, about his life. And he was a NASCAR racer. He's, you know, one of the biggest real estate companies in the world. So I try to get stuff from everyone, not just athletes, but I try to learn from everybody. And mental is the way to go. That's the mind. They say that 80% of it's mind. You know, if you have a little bit of skill and the mind to do it, you can do it. And that's what I really believe that.
Yeah, man, I appreciate the love, man. I gave a talk to the NFL Association alumni down there for some competitive high trainers. They had this competition going on. And more science is beginning to show the power of the actual belief. And what people don't separate is the feelings, the thoughts, and beliefs. We think we just think something, and then we think if we can just replay that thought over and over, it'll be. When truly, if you don't go deeper than that, what you really believe about life, others, yourself, what you believe about yourself as a fighter, about the world, about even your competition, if somewhere beneath all those fake thoughts you're creating is really some negative belief, well, that belief will manifest very quickly right in the ring. So you can do all the reframing thoughts you want to try to control the emotions in the moment, but it's about trying to get down to what you really believe and pulling that out. Most people don't even know what they really believe. They know what to say. They know what to say, what sounds good. They know what to think to make it think right. But if you don't go deeper, like you talked about when you were younger, I believe I can beat this guy. I believe I'm just as good as they are. That's different than just going, well, deep inside, I may believe that this motherfucker is a badass, but I think I can do it. I think I can do it. Then that ring, all that goes away when the emotions are gone, the thoughts, and you have to respond to the beliefs and getting deeper in that. And that's beginning to now connect. I told a story about a woman, a single mother who got in a car wreck. They were T-boned on the side, and her six-year-old daughter was in the car, and she was thrown from the vehicle, and she runs back to the vehicle and lifts the car up. She literally lifts the Volkswagen Bug up and pulls her baby. Now, I've all had adrenaline rushes, and I've never been Hulk. I've never been able to pick up the car. But the question is, do you think for a moment that she actually thought that she couldn't?
No, not at all. Because, you know, I've had situations like that to where, I mean, I've actually been in a bad accident with my kids. We flipped over in a car, but I think that the mind is so powerful that she could do that. And I've heard about that. I've read stories. I mean, like I've seen it in myself to where I've lifted things or whatever that I, you know, you can't, you look back on it, you're like, how did I do that? Or, you know, but you hear about this and no, I think that definitely that does happen and it has happened. So, you know, it's weird. Like we talk about mental is so it's amazing. I saw a video on Facebook maybe a year ago is a father getting his daughter ready for school, and he's telling her stuff like, hey, you know, you're beautiful, say you're beautiful, she repeats it. Believe it or not, I do that to my daughter every day. I drop it off. My daughter has a real bad case of eczema, and you know, today when I dropped her off, I said, look, I'm pretty, my skin is good. She'll repeat after me. I'm like, I'm gonna do good today, I'm gonna have fun. You know, she's getting to the age to where she's still in third grade, but to where kids will make fun of her or whatever shit has in her face. I'm like, don't listen to them. They're just jealous of you. Just keep going. And I think she's feeding off that because her skin is getting better. It's crazy. But, you know, I tell her, I'm like, Ariana, you're beautiful. She's, I'm beautiful, Dad. Okay. You're going to go do good in school. And we do that every morning, which to me is great because you start telling kids that they're going to believe it. You start telling the kid they're dumb, they're stupid, they're going to believe that. Start them at a young age and they'll start building up on that. And I believe it. It's great. I mean, it's great to be positive to people. And you feel better. You feel better when you're positive. If you come home with a negative, I tell my wife, if you're negative at work, leave all that out the door. I don't want you to bring it in. Let's not talk about work. Let's just focus on this. So the more you do that, I think the more happy you're going to be, the more positive you're going to be. You're going to be healthy. Just live a better life. Life's short, brother. You know that. And you got to enjoy it because think about it. 100 years goes by really fast. You know?
Yeah, if we're lucky, man. You got me all beclimp talking about your daughter like that, man. You should show her this video where in a classroom, they did an elementary school, I think, or middle school, to where each student had a plant. And in this plant, they on either side of the room, right? And every day they would talk nasty and mean to one plant and then talk kindly to another. And over time, the plant that was spoken nasty to actually withered and died. And the other one grew and stayed strong. Wow. You know, and that, I mean, those words, they send vibrations, they send real beliefs. And like I said, those beliefs connect to our outer side and our inner, it's all connected. And, you know, what you're doing for her, my brother, is good. It changes her life, because what she starts thinking and repetitive motions will change what she believes. And I'd also tell her, if you're spiritual like that, man, we don't get tested with things like that unless we're strong enough. And thank God that she's strong enough to wear that and some other girl doesn't. Because that's just going to make her stronger and push her to that next level of some sort of level she may not even understand right now.
Yeah, you know, it's so funny, bro, as you said that, and it kind of chokes me up to say it. But so I injured my back. I did federal security for a company, and I slipped on some ice a year ago. I mean, I'll tell you right now, yesterday, brother, I was in so much pain. I had to get about 20 injections in my back of a steroid and, you know, some numbing agent, whatever it was. And I went to the emergency room to see if there's anything they can do. They couldn't. But I'm driving my daughter, and she's like, "Dad, I can't believe after a year your back is still here." She goes, "I got asthma and eczema, and I'm fine, and I'm strong." And I'm like, "Wow." It was so seriously. I'm like, I can't believe she's saying that. So it was cool. And she's like, "Yeah." She's like, basically, like, "Suck it up, Buttercup. Stop being a little kid." And I'm just like, "Wow." But yeah, it's things like that. And I wanted to do one more thing. So my son is a sophomore wrestler at a big school out here, and you know, he almost qualified for state. Well, before state, he tells me, he's like, his name's Hunter. He said, "Dad, so I already bought my tickets for state, so I'm going either way." I'm like, "What are you talking about? You're going either way? No, go refund them tickets. You're going to go to state. You can't be thinking that, you know, you're already thinking that you're going to lose. You can't think that way, son." I said, "Go in there, know that you're going to get a seat to state because you're going to qualify for state." So that's kind of one thing when you mention, I'm like, yeah, you got to stay positive. And little things like that, little comments that fighters or kids or whoever make, you got to catch them on that. And, you know, "Oh, well, I might not keep this job that long because I'm not doing good." I mean, you start thinking negative like that, and you're going to probably end up being negative. So yeah, focusing on being positive and just telling yourself, even if you truly don't believe it, you tell yourself enough, and you're eventually going to believe it. So that's why I said I love your thinking. I love your book, that you know, your everything that you're trying to do, and whatever I can do to help on that. I mean, I tell you what, man, I'm not bragging, but I've been around the world, and I got to train. I was over in China. I went over with the American Scholars Program and trained their Chinese boxing team two times, 2004, 2006. I mean, I was just with one of the owners of the Pittsburgh Steelers, Brian Rooney, the other day, a friend of mine I went to high school with. They're best friends. Meeting these guys, just sitting and talk to them, met Muhammad Ali. I did bodyguard service for Ralph Macchio. For Stan Lee. I mean, it's great. I'm writing a book right now. It's been in the process for the last 12 years, but it's called The Champion's Life. It just talks about these philosophies. I'll just be honest, with my food truck company, I haven't had the time to do anything. I'm so busy.
Let me help you with it, man. You need help with that book. I'll help you out, man.
And I'd appreciate it, because I got so much life stories to tell. You know, when it's so funny when I meet people, I can honestly say they're like, "This is probably the biggest bullshitter we've ever met." But then they start looking, or I'll show them a Facebook picture, and I'll do this or that. Like, "Oh yeah, I fought in front of Muhammad Ali." Who else does that? You know, he was in Biloxi, Mississippi. Look, here's the pay-per-view video if you want to see it. I fought 34 MMA fights. So like, really? Then we'll go to YouTube if you don't believe me. There's guys that say, "With you," that's crazy. And I was going to bring this up about the Conor McGregor thing. So the lady friend of mine from Reebok, she's like, "Hey, you should do something like a to get people's attention." So I met Conor when I was out at the Tough 24 filming. Henry Cejudo was in the room getting interviewed, and he's out there, and he was training for camp for Diaz. And he's like, "What the fuck's up with your boy Henry? He's taking up all my time training." I'm like, "Oh, we can't go in there." But I said, "Hey, man, how you feeling? My name's Frankie Sanchez. Nice to meet you. I'm Henry's, one of his coaches out here." And we basically just talked for about 30 minutes. And, you know, I just asked him. He is one of the most humble guys in MMA that I've met, you know. And his wife, who's having a baby with him, is so beautiful. I mean, I was telling the fighters, I'm like, "That out of all these people you see in Vegas, she's one of the most beautiful women I've ever seen." His whole team was there, but we talked, we took a selfie. And then so, you know, this big fight with Mayweather, because I know Mayweather also, I fought his sparring partners. I've been to his gym 100 times. And my buddy trained some fighters there. But I said, I put it on for April Fool's joke, and it worked. I mean, it hit. People were hitting it all over. I was getting calls from all over the country.
It worked for me.
Really training McGregor. I'm like, we wait till tomorrow. But it was truly an April Fool's joke. But like I said, the good thing is people said, "Frankie, for you, we wouldn't put it past you. That's why we're asking you. We really thought it was true. But, you know, you're with the guy." But I did tell him. I gave him my card, and I said, "Hey, if you ever want specific wrestling, Henry's your man. If you want boxing, or whatever, I'll be happy to work with you." So, you know, it's not out of the question. But yeah, it was great. But got a ton of hits, got people calling me from all over. And I'm like, people watch me more than I think. So that's what's great,
though. Yeah. You got me, man. I've been promoting the shit out of it like that, man.
Hey, though, I said, oh, you know, no, man, I'm going to have to call him up. And I said, I'm going to Twitter him and say, hey, you see this? You better bring me on to your camp. But, you know, I wouldn't put it past me. I mean, I got a lot of good connections, and we'll see, man. But do I think that fight's going to happen? I do. And it's going to be the biggest fight in history, money-wise. And, yeah, McGregor will lose, but he's smart if he fights. And if it was an MMA fight, he'd kill Mayweather. But McGregor will lose because Mayweather's a beast. He really is. He trains very hard.
And, well, Conor won't lose boxing if Frankie Sanchez gets in his corner, though.
That's what I'm talking about, right? So that's what we said. If he really wants to win, I have some tricks that can beat Mayweather. So, yeah, we can do that.
Oh, well, I'll drop you a little look into, man. I went through some back issues back when I was balling, man. I was about 240, big dude all the time, played linebacker, and I was struggling, man. I was trying everything that I knew and everywhere, the shots, you name it. And I found it's a guy named Naudi Aguilar, does functional patterns. And I've been doing that ever since. It's been, 4 years now since I've really been doing it. But I dropped them down to 180. Haven't had a back issue since, man. It changed my life. And Jeremy, the Heathen Stevens, he trains with him too. He's got the fight coming up. He's been using functional patterns. It's man, it's an amazing biomechanic science, dude. I promise you, you go see Naudi in Seattle or one of his trainers around, dude, that back pain will go away, man. He's changing people with bent spines. It's just magic, man.
Wow. And that's good to know because, you know, one of the coaches who I coach with, Eric Albatasin, he has a fighter fighting on Friday anyway for Bellator, but he's a real big believer in stem cell. Have you done heard anything about that for your people? Or stem
cell? We've had two guys actually on the show, Dr. Mike Van Thielen and Dr. Greg Carter, that are huge fan of the stem cells, one of the older ways to do it and the newer ways to do it. And you can actually go out of the country to places like Peru, Germany, Vietnam, and they'll do stuff to where they're putting it in your heart and in your brain. I mean, it's just deleting diseases. And stem cell done the proper way, man, basically no invasive if you do it the new way, nothing invasive. It can change over 3 days, maybe even a few treatments. That's an amazing approach. But before any more needles, brother, I promise you, get into that functional patterns, man. Just start at the beginning, and he'll walk you through. Like, he's the biomechanic genius, man. He's a little mad scientist. I call him a little brown brother. I love the shit out of him. Nice. But he's a mad dog, dude. And it changed my life, man. I was thinking surgery every day. I went to three different doctors. Ashley Kramer actually had it way worse than me with some back issue, literal spine bent like this. And now he's straight just like this, walks with no pain. It changed my life, dude. And it's a whole new way of training. And it's not even necessarily training as much as it is getting your biomechanics right. It actually makes you hit harder, you use less energy when you're using all the myofascia tissue. I'm going to butcher this shit because I'm just a novice white belt, if you will, right now. Right. But, dude, it'll change your back completely, man.
And that's why it's awesome I'm talking to you, because, you know, you get guys like us who've been around and you can help each other. Maybe someone's listening to this and says, hey, well, let me try this, let me try that. But I'll tell you what, man, and, you know, my family don't even know this, but I've been hurting, man. I mean, I had a lot of injuries as, you know, just little injuries, I guess, nose, ears messed up, but nothing really bad. But this back injury, like I said, I did federal security. I slipped on some ice and landed on my gun. Since then, man, I haven't been the same. And now my business is taking off so much as the food truck. You know, we do all these concerts. We have a contract with Fiddler's Green, which is our big amphitheater out here. And we do tacos, burritos, nachos, and it's called North of the Border Grill. It's so big now, but I can't do it, man. Physically, my body's just going to collapse on me. Like I said yesterday, I had to go to the emergency room, and they gave me some, you know, shots and things like that. But mentally, man, that's the only thing that's getting me through it. I told my wife, someone in my same situation at 44 years old, they would break. They couldn't even walk. How I do it sometimes, I don't know. Now, and I don't want to turn this into a church or Christian thing, but I really believe in God. And, you know, I pray a prayer every night. I don't go to church every Sunday. I mean, I'm usually resting or we have events, but you believe in something. There's got to be a higher power than us, you know, why we're here. And I really believe in God, and I believe that He's guided me through my dark times, you know, to where I didn't know what I was going to do, you know, in a tough situation, whatever. You turn to Him and you turn to your spirituality, and I think that helps. And just giving back to the community, karma is a son of a gun. And if you do it, I'm telling you, man, I've seen so many times to where, you know, I've done good things just on my own. And whatever, go take a meal to someone or buy somebody a lunch, give someone a jacket, a homeless guy. And that next day, I shit you not, man, I got this last year, We did some good things feeding the homeless. 2 days later, I'll even show you an email. I received a grant from the WBC, the boxing community, for $7,000, a grant just to help out. You know, you're struggling. What are you doing? And it was amazing. So it's things like that that people need to believe in. You need to read these stories. You need to believe in the girl picking up a car with, you know, her adrenaline, because trust me, man, if you do right in life, you will succeed. It might be right away, but it will come at you, because I'm not in the point now to where I should be. I mean, you know, I try to help people out my whole life, and it seemed to have fallen in place. And when you do something good, something else is going to happen to you good. And don't expect it. It will happen.
Yeah, I'm with you, man. When I was going through stuff, you know, I was kind of raised in the spirit for a while. And it seems like sometimes the closer you get to the church, the harder it is to believe. Yeah. And I think a lot of people they convolute a lot of things when, you know, I've studied the Bible and the Quran, I've studied a lot of them. And what I pull from all of them really is just love God above all else and love your neighbor like yourself. And I think if we do that and we help other people, we cultivate the talents that we've been given, but not to benefit ourselves, but to benefit others. I mean, those seem like three simple rules. I don't think you need the Ten Commandments and all the freaking laws. I think if we do those three things, anything's possible, truly, from lifting up cars to coming back from back injuries to Conor McGregor winning over Floyd Mayweather in a boxing match. Anything can be that possible in the belief, my brother. And, please, if you're in Aurora or Denver, I know there's some FP masters out there in Denver. There's very few that are master trained like Nowdy, but I'm pretty sure Nowdy would see you definitely. He's actually, I forget where Jeremy Stevens is fighting this weekend, but he's in his corner. So, yeah, Kansas City. So he's brought him into his corner. They got some videos up of what they're doing. I being an ex-baller like I was, I played linebacker since I was probably 1 year old. That's what it feels like. And you take head collisions like that, then a little bit of fighting afterwards, all that kind of stuff, man. If people don't understand the kind of pain, you know, that we're taught, right? That pain is gain, right? You just live through it. And I could walk around with a 7 spike into a 9 sometimes in a back pain. And my God, dude, more than nutrition, more than lifting weights, more than anything I ever did, when I started just implementing the basic steps of FP, functional patterns, man, no back pain. I'm not even a 2. I'm not a 1. Wow. I don't even have days.
Man, that's amazing. That's, you know, it's great you said that. I was just talking to a fighter the other day about, you know, the junior, what they call it, the junior sale disease, getting hit so much in your head that you can't handle it. And I talked to my wife about that, and I said, man, you know, I've got MRIs, and I do have brain damage, and I have white matter all on my brain. And some of the doctors were even like, dude, I don't know how you're doing it. And I mean, for a while I was getting so bad migraines that it was kind of like I was telling you, going to a dark site. I was just like, man, is it even worth sticking around? I mean, my head hurts so much, and a normal man, I'm not trying to say I'm a badass, but any normal man could not handle the pain that I have. I don't know how I've done this, but you know, luckily, I take medication to go to bed at night, but I haven't had any really bad headaches. But I got to the point, bro, to where, I mean, I would sit in my car and just grab my head because it hurts so bad. But you got to think about it. I in my life, and I was telling my son this, I said, I probably had over 300 concussions in my life. I walk home from sparring one day to where my ears were ringing. I couldn't see straight. That was everyday thing for us. We didn't know better. And that's another thing I try to teach these fighters is like, look, your window is short. Yeah, you're sparring now with these 4-ounce gloves. Dude, in about 10 years, your brain's going to be mush. Look at this junior sale stuff that happened. You know, they basically say he just couldn't take it anymore. And I had kind of watched the show Concussion. I didn't watch it all, but it kind of brought me back to the things. And I mean, I remember as a youth playing football, I'd be walking home where I didn't even know where I was at. So you're talking about, and I'm not over-exaggerating on the 300 concussions, because I'll tell you what, I wrestled 5 years in the NCAAs. I boxed golden gloves. I boxed as a pro. I mean, you're talking about 60 to 70 times around you're getting nailed in the head, and you're doing sometimes sparring six to eight times rounds a day. You know, it just depends. So, but again, the mental part I think has brought me through it, because most men in my position, they'd be talking, slurring, stuttering, and that's what I don't want to see happen to these fighters nowadays, because it's a different sport. You know, you're using elbows, you're using knees. I mean, you know, few hits and you're done. So I tell my fighters, look, man, if I tell you you're done, you're done. You need to retire it. And regardless if you want to,
you're seeing it more and more. You're seeing guys retire early, etc. The guy just retired after his last fight there with DC. He was fighting. Yeah, yeah, Anthony Johnson, he walks away. I mean, Dr. Rhonda Patrick's one of the best people to look up when it comes to research about concussions. She talks about a simple, we've all hit our head on the corner of a kitchen cabinet before, and a simple bump that much can change brain functioning. So imagine how many right hooks, how many elbows, how many times you slam the mat. I got a tip when I was playing college ball. And I was hit by it was a massive man. It was one of the tackles. I think he went on to play for, I don't want to remember his name now. Almost had it. Fuck it. Well, I guess I got hit too many times. But anyway, when he hit me and I was walking up and one of the seniors on the team, he could tell that I was kind of out of it. And he goes, squint your eyes and walk toward the color. We're wearing green. And I was like, holy shit. Wow. And that stuck with me to where I know I take a concussion or a shot like that. You squint your eyes, then you just follow the color that you remember you're wearing.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're from that generation to where it's, put your finger back in place, get in there, shake it off. You know, that's where it came from. And the more we're learning from people like Dr. Rhonda Patrick is how much damage just a simple shot to the head can cause us. And, you know, I'll lead actually to a few couple questions here at the end, man, about some fighting stuff. Speaking of the sparring, are you for it? You do it less now with your fighters, now with this knowledge out there? Where do you see the sparring coming in?
Yeah, the way I like to do it is do it less. And, you know, I've heard of fighters, coaches, making these guys spar with the MMA gloves, the 4-ounce gloves, knocking each other out. Stupidest thing I ever heard of. And I told guys, yeah, I mean, it's hard now. I wrote a big Facebook post a couple years ago that I walked into a gym and these MMA guys were not wearing headgear. I'm like, why wouldn't you? Well, you got to get used to punches. I'm like, no, you cannot train for an elbow to your brain, no matter what you think. You just don't. You just got to learn how to take that. But I try to encourage them not to spar as much. Train, maybe a little bit of sparring, hard sparring before. But you got to figure, if you're going hard, say 2 weeks before a fight, and it's a $50,000 fight and you get cut, I mean, really, dude, what good is that going to do to you? So finally, some of the fighters are really listening to me in that. Other gyms, they don't care. But then again, they're not undefeated like us in the UFC. So, you know, it's I try to tell them, but fighters, and I remember Pantoja, he really didn't spar too hard a few weeks before his fight, because I said, look, man, this is your life here and this is your chance in the UFC. You know, you're going to get cut or something, or even if a head accidentally butts you and you're out of the fight, you got to call the fight off. So, you know, just get in shape cardio-wise, and it'll take care of the rest of itself in the ring. So, yeah, I really don't encourage a lot of sparring. I don't like to see young kids spar hard because, like I said, their brains are still developing. And, you know, luckily for me, I still have a little bit of brain left after all the wars, all the matches I've been through, all the football games. But, you know, again, I think that's just more training my brain. I think if you practice and practice, just like the seeing thing, if your eyes are off and you practice over and over some of these drills they give you, it's going to train your brain. So I think just by me training my brain that way is why I'm not in a hospital right now or getting migraines, severe migraines every day where I can't stand it. So mental toughness, brother, I can't say that enough. You know, just telling yourself over and over that you're meant to be here. You're meant to do good things. And I think that's what's kept me so long. But like I told my wife, I said, sometimes, sweetie, my head hurts so bad. I play it off for you guys. You know, I may take a drive because I don't want you to see me suffering. You know, because I did a lot in my life and I don't want you to see me suffering for the mistakes that I chose to stand in there and get hit by world champions, you know, but it's something that got me to where I am. I've helped a lot of people out. I think I've encouraged a lot of students to go on to be better, you go to college or whatever it is. And that's what my purpose here is in life, I think, is to help people. And who knows, maybe when my time's called, I'll get through the pearly gates, you know, hopefully.
Oh, man, for sure. Right. As long as we have hope in the heart, thus enters the man through the gates, not through his deeds, brother. And as long as we hold that hope, I think, and faith in our hearts, that's how we walk through those, man. And you provided a lot, man, for the youth, for your own kids, especially this interview, dropping some right things on there. I'll drop one of the harder questions at the end, man.
OK,
how do we take the fights out of the judge's hands?
You know, Dana White, let me see if I still have my picture. Let me see. Give me 1 second. I'm going to grab this picture.
Yeah.
So I'm glad you said that, because Dana White said it the best, right? And let's see if you can see this. Let's see, is that the camera? Yeah, Dana White put this one. Never leave it in the hands of the judges. He says it right. You know, don't let it, because unfortunately, judges are gonna be corrupt no matter what. You know, there's some great judges out there. I know a lot of great judges here in Colorado, a lot of great referees that will go, but you know, money tends to sway people. And do I believe fights are fixed? Of course. Have I seen fights been fixed myself? Yes. You know, I've seen money exchange hands in my last fight in Canada. I see money exchange hands from a commissioner to one of the coaches, you know, one of the promoters. So, yeah, I mean, of course, and are there bad decisions? Yes. You know, you get a fight to the level of like a Conor McGregor and a Mayweather to where you're talking about life changing for millions and millions of dollars. It happens, brother. And the best thing is never leave it in the hands of the judges. You gotta, and it's not as easy as I say it, but if you want to go out there and you really want to win, you better knock them out. If not, don't talk to me about it. You know, I mean, we learned that when we fought when Henry Cejudo fought Joe Benavidez for the finale. In my heart, in Henry's heart, we thought that Henry won the fight. They gave it to Joe. Well, guess what? We move on from that. Dana White himself actually knew that Henry won. Send him the win bonus anyway. So that's a great man, the Dana. You may hear a lot of negative or whatever.
I love him. I fucking love Dana. He gets some shit, but dude, that I love him, man. He built something from nothing with some help of some good people. I love him, man. He's a no apologetic type of dude.
Yeah, and he tells you straight when you meet him. He curses just like a sailor, and he'll tell you, you know, don't F around. You know, if I let you guys go out, don't screw around because I will kick you off. This is a business. And he lets you know. And if you don't follow his rules, good enough. You should be kicked off. It's just like any other job. But yeah, to answer your question, you're always going to have that from the beginning of time. If I fight you in your hometown, regardless of how much I whoop you up, if you're standing on your feet, you could possibly win. So the best thing is, like you said, he has it right there on the tough wall, locker room. Never leave it in the hands of the judges. So if you're, I mean, you know, it's up to them. And you're always going to get that, but you're always going to have good judges. But, you know, that, unfortunately, that's turning a lot of people away from the boxing part of it. You know, well, is it fixed by the judges? Yeah, but you're never going to change that unless, you know, even if they go to like they put the things in the gloves that make you, you know, score catchers or whatever, count how many punches, still not going to. They try that in the Olympics. You know, Roy Jones got robbed in the Olympics. There's a lot of guys that, you know, got robbed, and that's always going to be. So just, I guess, knock them out if that's what you really want. You know, don't leave it up to them. That's the best advice I can give.
Yeah, two of my good friends are big promoters in Florida and some amateur and pro fights, Zach Moore and Dan Donaldson. They were kind enough to let me judge a few MMA bouts, and I was kind of all over the state going to them. I just wanted to experience it, and I got a new respect for the ones that aren't corrupt, that are really trying to do it, because when it's a close fight like that, man, I remember sitting there, and they want your score like right away. You know, so you're trying to score it. I came up with my own method of scoring, and I called PTSD. It seemed to work with post-traumatic stress disorder. It was like punches, takedowns, significant strikes, and defenses, PTSD. And I was trying to grade it, and there were a couple fights where I'm going, fuck, man. I don't know, you know? And so I have a much, much more newfound respect by judging those fights, to where you're really sitting there when it's close, and how you judge and how you lean. So, I mean, shout out to them and all my friends too at Fusion XL down there. Julian's got a big fight coming up. I know Platinum Mike Perry and Alex Nicholson, they're coming up to fight. Every one of those guys are training out of Fusion. I love and I miss them very much, man. Sorry they hit me. And JT, my boy. Oh, man, I get all beclimbed thinking about my dogs I miss. But yeah. You do start to miss them. And I can imagine what it's like being a fighter, you know, and on the road and away from your family for 2-3 months at a time. You know, maybe not seeing them until fight night even. That's got to be it's a tough road, man.
Builds character, bro. You got to do it. That's part of the fight game. Sometimes you got to, like you said earlier, get away from them distractions, because a lot of that can really affect you. And like I tell these guys, you're fighting for your life in there. It's not like you're going in playing tennis. One kick to the head and you're done. Just know that. And I make sure they know that. And that kind of, I guess, prepares them a little bit mentally tough. I'm not going to lie to them and sugarcoat it and say, oh, you'll be okay. I mean, yeah, you definitely can come out with brain damage. So just so you know, this is a tough sport. Your window of opportunity is short, so get it done, and you know, be as safe as you can. And then when you leave, don't come back to it, because you're out for a reason. And you know, you got blessed with that career. End it, you know. So that's what I try to tell them.
See a lot of fighters, they do, and I love that advice. They try to come back, and sometimes I watch and I'm like, oh no, don't do it. You know, you're already out of it mentally. Ronda was one of them. The boxer that came back, what's his name? Just got knocked out of the ring for his last fight. Older guy.
Bernard Hopkins.
Yeah, Bernard. Like, you watch it and you go, son of a bitch, just please, just put it down, man.
Yeah, you got to do that. You got to end it when – you should know when your time's up, if not your coaches should, because I won't coach a fighter who I think is going to – you know, I'll just let him know, man, it's not going to want you to get hurt, you know. So that's the only advice I give them, is if I tell you you're not ready or you need to hang it up. You should hang it up. You should take my advice.
Yeah, to end it on something stronger, I think you kind of rampaged on a lot of it already. If you were talking, say, to a fighter who may feel like he's in the biggest fight of his life, this could be his first pro fight, maybe his UFC debut, maybe even their first amateur bout, whatever that is, what feels like to them their biggest fight, and you're in their corner before they come out of that tunnel, what would you tell them?
You know, I tell them, and like I usually tell all of them, is that, you know, you go out there and leave it all in the ring. You know, I don't want you back in the locker room saying, I should have done this, I should have done that. You know, if you're tired, whatever it is, you got to give everything you have. This is what you train for. You may have not had the best camp, but mentally, you just got to go give it everything. Go for broke. Don't hold anything back. Because I've heard fighters say, man, if I would have just done this or if I would have done that, and that will haunt them for the rest of their lives. I've had guys that, you know, a buddy of mine, we wrestled together in the state finals, and he lost. He was 29-0. Got taken down in the state finals and got beat. And that haunts me and him both our whole lives, because they're like, well, we should have done that or should have done this. I said, don't have any regrets, man. Just go and do it. You know, if you say you should have thrown 100 punches, then throw 101. I mean, but do it. And you just try to encourage him. Trust me, this is your opportunity. And to me, every fight's an opportunity. The best fighter, the most important fight of life, because you could move on. You can get hurt, you can get killed. So go out there and give it your all. If you're going to go out and bang, then go out. But I want you to, don't want you to complain to me in the locker room that, you know, you should have done this or that. Do it in the ring. You have the opportunity to do it now. And that's it. That's all I can encourage him to do, is leave it all in the ring. You know,
all right, man. I'm ready, man. I'm fucking ready. Where are we going, man?
Yeah.
Where are we going, Frankie?
Here we come.
Yeah, I'm in, man. Holy shit. Yeah, you get me wild up and hyped, man. I was actually watching that fight when the Dream Team did the thing, and I saw you guys sitting around in the Dream Team label. I was watching that one, man, and when it got booked through Patricia, I went, no fucking way, man. I was like, this is awesome, man.
Yeah,
and I love it. So anytime you ever want to come back yourself, man, after a fight, before a fight, got an up-and-coming fighter you want to get some notoriety to, or a fighter you're with, you want to get out there with, man, the mic is yours anytime, brother.
And I appreciate that. And what I'm going to do, I have a few UFC shirts that I don't know how we can do this. Maybe you can announce it on your show, get some, if someone listens to this cast or whatever, they could answer some questions, and whoever gets them, I can donate 5 t-shirts to your program. We can get them out to them. I can send them to them. So have them call in or whatever it is to you, or email, ask them some questions about this interview. And if they get it right, we'll ship it out, man. You know?
Dude, I love it, man. We just probably about a week, we get all orders in of our new Cognitive Rampage shirts and tank tops, man. Let me just send you a couple to give to some of those younger kids that you give away, and remind them about how the mental game in life is just as tough.
Will do, brother. But no, I appreciate you having me on. It's been an honor. You know, like I said, I saw a few of your interviews, and I loved it. And me to be considered on this caliber, to be even offered on your spot, is great. And whatever I can do to help you too. So got a huge network, and definitely love to come out and see you in person out there. But love what you're doing, man. And I know a lot of people are going to watch this. And hopefully, you know, they all, like you said earlier, you know, just any little bit of help, $10, $20, $30, go into that PayPal and help you keep the show going, because you're on the right track with the mental part of it, because that's how we're winning. We're not winning. There's so many athletes that are better than us, and it's all mental. But they're not mentally tougher than us, and they don't know how to coach mental toughness. So that's what I think we're successful. You know, with the Olympic champion Henry Cejudo on his team, and he's fighting Sergio Pettis on May 13th. So we'll be there. That's a huge card in Texas. So you know, let's see if it works. We're undefeated right now in that part of it with the guys we're training. So hopefully Henry gets on the road of beating him and getting back to a title fight with the winner of Demetrius and the fighter he's fighting out of Brazil this weekend. So we'll see.
Yeah, I'm always here. Anytime anybody needs any, man, I'm a phone call away. I'll give that shit away for the most part, man. But thank you so much, man. You're blessed in everything you're doing, and thanks for blessing everybody with the things that you know and what you do, man. Thank you very much.
I appreciate it, man. And yep, thanks again. And you guys have a wonderful weekend. Stay positive. That's all I can say. Think positive.
I love it, man. Love you, buddy.
Take care, bro. Thanks, man.
Bye. Man, dog, you can feel the passion in Frankie, man. Somebody I'd want in my corner if I was fighting, I can promise you that. If I was doing that, you can see the knowledge, what he's been through, what he's experienced. To be able to sit in a gym probably and hit the mitts with him and listen to some of those words, or just kind of get in that flow state of loss with a guy like that, I think would be a blessing. Maybe one day I can hit some mitts with the legend Frankie himself. I enjoyed that. He gave all that away to us, and we'll probably see him back on the show some more. It's an open invitation, but you know, think about everything he's saying from the mental game and apply that to your own life. Even if you're not a fighter, I think everything Frankie said here is easily applied into your own life, whether it's a job or a family or relationships, and especially self is, you know, keeping it positive, stay focused no matter what happens. You know, I write in my book about becoming the master of the silver lining, and I've interviewed a lot of people, and I can tell you that Frankie really, really seems to be the master of the silver lining, something that I think is important to instill in fighters, in your own life, and especially into your kids. And he's doing that with his own daughter and his son, etc. So it was quite the honor to talk to Frankie. And I apologize about the Connor thing. He got me. He got me. I didn't realize it was an April Fool's joke. So April Fool's on me. Apologize. Most of you probably deep in the game already knew that. I tend to be a spectator and just enjoy it that much. Like I said, I don't get deep. But either way, doesn't matter. And Connor, if you do listen, which I know you don't, but if you do, I actually post most of your mental training videos on the Athletes Revelations page. I love the way you prepare and that you put that out there. Maybe it's a consideration you put Frankie Sanchez in your corner for real, man. He brings a lot of knowledge and a lot of love. So anyway, a lot of love to you all out there. Yeah, I appreciate the love. Like he was saying, he already put it up there. If you can, man, go to adamlowry.com, go to the donate. Try to keep this, it's not try to keep the show going. I'm going to fucking push my ass off to do it anyway. But over time, it starts to wear on you and get expensive. So that's anything will help, man, whether it's $1 or $2, whatever, man. I'd appreciate the love. But yeah, love everybody. The second edition will be out on 420. I got to go get some sunlight. I got to recoup. It's been a doubleheader podcast day to day. Hope you're taking care of you. Hope you're living your cognitive rampage. Love you.